It's my ambition to really liberate the world. Why not? I mean, why settle for anything less? And I have a sense of humor about it. I know the odds are against me, but we only have a few years here. Let's try to leave this spaceship a better place.
The Harvard professor who became the outlaw acid king of the 1960s is dead.
Timothy Leary has died as he lived, in a rather unconventional fashion.
He died at his Beverly Hills home at the age of 75.
He was a counterculture icon of the 60s, an author, a lecturer, an ex-con, and a celebrity.
His zest for dying was not unlike his zest for living life to the fullest. In 1967, he counseled a world of young people to, quote, turn on, tune in, and drop out. Many of them did with psychedelic drugs, but he was also a researcher, psychologist, author, scientist, lecturer.
To me, he was a driven man and a great philosopher and a seeker of the truth and a futurist, and he always kept a very positive attitude and always kept working and working and working and always saying, if I make too much money, you have to tell me because that means I'm doing something wrong.
One of his greatest moments of excitement came just 2 days ago when he saw a 3-minute video and learned that some of his remains would be carried into outer space.
So when he saw that burst of that light, he said, that's me.
This rogue intellectual, this visionary genius, will be around on the webnet for the cyber generation and beyond.
Timothy Leary, by the way, had said that he was thrilled to learn that he had inoperable prostate cancer. To him, death was just a promising adventure. And when it came for him this morning, he left behind a lot of people who say they will miss him and some who say they will not.
Oh, Danny boy, the pipes are calling. From glen to glen and down the mountainside. The summer's gone and all the flowers are dying. It's you must go and I must bide. But come ye back when summer's in the meadow, or when the valley's hushed and white with snow. It's I'll be here in sunshine or in shadow. Old Danny boy, old Danny boy, I love you so. But when ye came and all the flowers are dying and I was dead, as dead I will maybe, ye'll come and find the place where I am lying and kneel and say an ave there for me. And I will hear those soft you tread above me, and all my grave will warmer, sweeter be. And ye will bend and tell me that you love me. And I will sleep in peace until you come to me.
psychology 20 years ago, basically as a career. I was simple-minded enough to take seriously the mottos of psychology, that psychology is supposed to be finding out what goes on with the human being. And 5 years ago, by accident in Mexico, I took Mexican mushrooms, the so-called magic mushrooms of Mexico, and I learned more about my brain and its possibilities, and I learned more about psychology in the 5 hours after taking these mushrooms than I had in the preceding 15 years of studying, doing research in psychology.
What were you really advocating then?
Well, my main message is use your head. Specifically, learn how to use your nervous system. It's this, for the last 15 years, I've been studying my own nervous system. I've gotten to use my own nervous system the way Leeuwenhoek and the first men that got the microscope, or Galileo, the first guy that got the telescope. It takes years to learn how to focus it and dial it and tune it. I know that the nervous system is a computer. We can program it in many different directions. It's like a series of motion picture or television cameras. We can focus it and turn it around on different objects. It's electronic, it's electric, we can dial it and tune it, it's there to be used. And the challenge of the human race right now, I call it the neurological age we're going into, we've got to learn how to use our heads.
LSD is an extremely powerful mind-opening agent. We are now in the psychochemical age. In the future, it's not going to be what book do you read, but which chemical do you use to open your mind to accelerate learning.
The drug revolution in America was a disaster, and to the extent that Timothy Leary promoted that, he was the high priest of the drug revolution. He had, of course, a philosophy that went beyond that, but I'm talking about the main thing that he did had a very negative effect.
Are you ahead of your time? Is that why you haven't been accepted totally yet? Are you too far ahead of...
Yes, I'm in a kind of a time war.
Timothy Leary was the psychedelic movement's prophet of perception, a high-profile LSD advocate who was scaring the hell out of mainstream America.
We are neurologically and biochemically in touch with thousands of generations that came before us. It's just that our mental, symbolic minds can't decode these messages. And men have been discovering this experience and developing methods to get high or to go out of their mind for thousands of years.
I think that I was the person that was in a position of stature and respectability and basically power. I could say this because I didn't want tenure. I didn't want to be a professor. I didn't want government funded. The government never gave us a dime for our research. Some private groups did. So that I simply wasn't intimidated, and everything we were doing was legal and open.
There are a lot of people, young, usually men, the aim of their whole thing is to get to Harvard. They're like salmons coming upstream. They flop into Harvard, and they know that's the end. They're Harvard professors. The same time you've had at Harvard for a long time, people like the counterculture and the transcendental and the all-is-one movement. You had Emerson and you had Thoreau. Remember Thoreau and Emerson? Thoreau was in prison. You know what? When Emerson came, he said, "What are you doing in there, David?" And he said, "What are you doing out there?" I mean, Thoreau, one of our great, great philosopher, was in prison for failing to pay a tax to support the Mexican War.
The man in the middle with glasses, Richard Alpert, one of the two Americans most often blamed or praised for the psychedelic revolution.
I've had, as I say, LSD over 300 times, and one of the dramatic characteristics of the psychedelic experience is being with another person and suddenly seeing the ways in which they are like you.
We had a lot of kind of charming hysteria for a while, yes, humor and stuff. And then I went off into the living room and I started to have this very dissociative experience.
So you start to have this dissociative experience of where all that you become is awareness, is a point of awareness. That's all that's left. I remember the first time this happened to me, as professor went and middle class boy went and pilot went, and all of my games were like going off into the distance.
Like I only had a body left, and then I couldn't find my body, look with my eyes open, and I got frightened.
And I got the panic, which is the panic that precedes the psychological death, because indeed Richard Alpert was dying at that point. And the panic was, no, stop, stop, I've got to hold on to something so I'll know who I am.
And I was about to scream for Timothy when I went through the doorway. I mean, I said, who's about to scream?
And Timothy, the wise old Timothy, always says things like, trust your nervous system.
Suddenly, when I became so free in knowing who I was and being, resting in my being. And I thought, boy, have I been screwed my whole life. I have been cut off from this thing. And I went out cartwheeling in the snow outside Tim's house.
When we first started our research at Harvard, we middle-class professors didn't know what this was about. One thing we learned right from the beginning is, don't use the language of psychiatry, because the language of psychiatry is a sick, well, doctor, patient, you've got this neurosis, you've got the psychosis, almost forcing the person to be a victim.
We were heretics at Harvard. And then we were heretics in a society because you're advocating the overthrow. Come on in, Ralph. Hi.
Dr. Ralph Metzner, a psychopharmacologist and Timothy Leary's principal assistant.
When you take LSD, everything falls apart. All learned structures, all thought patterns, all beliefs, opinions, emotional convictions, positive or negative, they all fall apart. How a person sees himself, what he thinks of himself.
Huxley and Gerald Hurd and Humphrey Osmond and various people said, no, no, you can't, you know, tell everybody to turn on. This has to be kept quiet. It's kind of, you'd say, no, that's an elitist thing, you know. Time for that is past. The need is too great.
You're not saying LSD cannot be misused.
Well, of course, it's a form of energy, and it releases energy, and any form of energy which a man has discovered can be used for ill or for good. It can be used to gain power, control over other people, or it can be used to help people develop and grow.
And we had spent about a year on the faculty together, teaching a course together. He was a widower with two children. Everybody else in that situation knows they're at Harvard and they're playing it for what they can do with it, and I mean, there's a tremendous amount of publish and perish and all of that sort of thing. And Timothy was just different than that. He didn't care. When I came back to Harvard in February, he already had a project going, and his project was basically saying, the experience I had in Mexico was true and profound. These things are treated in my culture as psychotomimetics by the psychiatric community, as pathology-inducing things. I think that's the wrong metaphor for them. I'm going to do research as a Harvard professor. I think that's an incredibly big leap.
Scientific studies have proven that the human brain has dozens, maybe over 100 receptor sites. These are little locks to the brain. And each of these receptor sites has been designed over millions of years by DNA, genetics, to be opened up by a certain plant that's out there. That's very poetic, that the plant queendom for thousands of years has been evolving in synchronicity with mammals, warm-blooded mammals with brains. And still today, these plants have this automatic effect on the brain. Nothing happens by synchronicity or accident, I think, in evolution.
What charmed me about Timothy was his ability to continually undercut the parameters of my mind. He was constantly pushing the edges of the envelope, you might say. He was constantly looking at things in a slightly different way.
He had a gift for talking to large groups of people that was totally phenomenal, you know, kind of this Irish oratory. And if you look at what happened in the 60s with psychedelics, the 60s was the birth of the civil rights movement, it was the beginning of the ecology movement, it was the beginning of the women's movement, it was the liberation movement, it was the beginning of the sexual revolution, it was the beginning of the anti-war movement. And I would, and rock and roll, and tremendous cultural creativity yeah. that was released, and I would be willing to bet that in every single one of those movements, some psychedelic experiences played a role.
I think he had told me that he may have been an altar boy as a kid.
He told me that his dad was a dentist and was the first person that turned him on to nitrous oxide when he was just a kid. And he liked that a lot. His mom was very straight-laced and, from what I understand, very disapproving. He also tells me that his grandfather had tons and tons of books. And Tim used to go visit his grandfather in his grandfather's room and take some of the books. And I think his grandfather told him, Timothy, don't ever be like everybody else.
Before he discovered LSD, he was this, you know, sort of iconoclastic, rabble-rouser Irish type.
Timothy Leary's rented estate is almost as fantastic by day as it is by night. 3,000 acres, complete with man-made lakes, in the rolling woodlands of upstate New York.
We were visited by people from every form of consciousness experimentation. Yogi, we're wall-to-wall yogis and swamis and Taoists and tea leaf readers and vegetarians and anything. We're interested. We wanted to know, because we were square Harvard professors and we didn't know much about this.
Peggy Hitchcock, who was a friend of ours, said, I think my brother's just bought this place, this cattle ranch, and there's an old house on it up in Millbrook. Let's go. And we drove up, she and I came to this house. A 63-room house, all boarded up, but indoor walk-in refrigerators, 9 bathrooms. I said, this is our place. She said, well, if you want it, you'll have to turn on my brothers. They were both 22. They were part of the Mellon family. So at that point, I took on my project of turning them on. The first year was absolutely unbelievably idyllic. We had this incredibly beautiful home. We had a web of friends and a network of creative and interesting people pouring in and out. We had the New York City scene plus the Millbrook scene. And then there were these weekends where everybody just played together. Maynard Ferguson was down the gatehouse with Flo and the kids. There were football games. It was like the Kennedy years at Hyannis Port or something like that. It had that quality. Wonderful big feasts and great experiments. And somebody was always on trips. We were always guiding trips there or running trips. And that was a very beautiful time.
He used to get phone calls that would come into to Millbrook and from people. And he would take these phone calls from people he didn't know who the hell they were at all. And a lot of them were people freaking out in LSD somewhere. They'd never taken it. And one of the most common things for them to say was, Dr. Leary, you've got to help me. I'm dying. I'm dying. He'd say, yes, you are dying. And then he'd say, so am I. And he explained the 50 billion year old life process and all the cells dying and living and dying, living, you know, a new body every 6 years and your own, blah, blah, blah. Pretty soon the person would be cooled out and wouldn't, you know, fly off a bridge or something.
There was a field where the last summer we all went out and moved out there and lived in teepees. We did that on Lunacy Hill, and it was lunacy for us to go out there. But also there was another hill further on called Ecstasy Hill. And these were all places where people would go and trip and do these wonderful things, throw off their clothes, have a marvelous time, swim in the lakes, whatever. It was 2,500 acres completely fenced in. It was a world unto itself.
People could take the psychedelics in whatever way they wanted as long as they wrote a report. And we made sure that it was in some way safe.
Local kids were saying, what's going on up there? We've got to go find out. So they would come up, and there were a lot of girls' schools. Vassar was nearby. There was Bernard Junior Girls' School in Millbrook. And they had signs on the school, any girl seen at Millbrook entering or leaving the property or there is immediately expelled. And that was true for all of them, because they'd come in and they'd go waltzing on back to college, turned on.
Allen Ginsberg first came to see us when we were just beginning, and we had a psilocybin mushroom drug session for him. I think Huxley was there. He was in one room upstairs, and his boyfriend Peter was in another one. During the experience, they wandered down through the house naked. It was a big, big kind of a mansion house, and it was almost Old Testament prophetic that here was a prophet coming. His eyes were gleaming.
Most everybody there took LSD. We settled down to discussing the situation, discussing the images being set up against everybody and reinforced, and listening to Joan Baez records on the phonograph, and chanting Buddhist prayer.
And I recommend respectfully to this committee that you consider legislation which will license responsible adults to use these drugs for serious purposes such as spiritual growth.
In about 2 or 3 in the morning, 1 in the morning, I'm not sure the time, I heard this sounds like this kind of this animal growling anger sound. Get up, get up! And I, you know, realized that it was some kind of problem, some kind of raid.
The first time that I was harassed by the law was on a Saturday night at midnight. I was in my bedroom with my wife, and I was talking to my son, and the door banged open, and in came G. Gordon Liddy with 24 armed and booted sheriffs.
Warrant? They have a warrant on hand?
Yeah, but the warrant was they found no marijuana. The warrant was thrown out. They did confiscate a little plant that we had on peat moss, which was a geranium.
Funny thing about Liddy is he was the one guy that was, like, nice, polite, was not a problem, didn't bully anybody, came up to me, said, hi, hello, how are you, what's your name? I took it on a clipboard, didn't try to arrest me, harass me, bother me, push me in a corner, anything else. And the people that were the assholes were the horrible, you know, sheriffs and the townsmen, you know, with the badges.
The Lord take me higher, let a bird can fly. The Lord take me higher until I touch the sky. The Lord take me higher to that sweet by and by. The Lord take me higher, hey, before I.
Tim got thrown out of every institution he ever belonged to, including the United States of America and Afghanistan and the Black Panther Party.
He got thrown out of, you know, West Point for smuggling alcohol, I think, right?
Yeah.
And not, and which everybody else was doing too. But.
I was actually thrown out of Holy Cross, but they let me stay on that evening, and same thing at West Point. No, they couldn't throw me out, but I agreed to resign if they apologized. And I got thrown out of the University of Alabama for spending the night in the girls' dormitory.
The Catholic Church never threw him out. He went away from the Catholic Church. I mean, I was with Matthew Fox. He got thrown out.
Right, yeah,
I said to him, right. I only got thrown out of Harvard. You got thrown out of the Catholic Church.
Boy, this big time.
Yes, big time stuff, baby.
I was married for 13 years to Rosemary Woodruff, who was a... We were together at Millbrook, and she helped me escape from prison. We were together in Europe and all that. And she now is spending a lot of time here. As a matter of fact, she was here last week, and she's coming back next week. So I'm still in very, very close touch with Rosemary. This is the house decorated by my ex-wife, Barbara, who left 2 years ago. We were together for 13 years. And her son, Zach, is the young man that's your host today.
You were also married to Nina, Uma Thurman's mother, right? And there was Joanna. And your first wife was Marianne, right?
And Editha's love, yes. We were together again for 11 years, yeah. And she killed herself on my 35th birthday. Huxley predicted how he wanted to die. And indeed, he did it himself. And I came to see him just down the road here at Mulholland Drive in Hollywood to bring him a copy of a book we'd written about it called The Tibetan Book of the Dying, and to talk with his wife Laura. And then 2 or 3 days later, as she's described in her book, this timeless moment, he wrote down LSD, and she gave him LSD, and Dr. Sidney Cohen, who's probably the most famous worldwide doctor on drugs, was there, and Dr. Cohen from UCLA gave him LSD, and he gave him also the going away pills that allowed him to die in peace and in dignity, the way he had written about in his own books. I consider the how you die to be the greatest decision you make in your life. We had no choice, after all, of where and with whom we were born. You know,
you were there in the womb and you popped it out and you didn't know what you were going to find. And in many of the great decisions in our life, like marriages or graduations, it's, you know, social and all that. But to arrange the greatest moment of your life should be the going away party, the graduation, the celebration. And I've been planning it for many years.
He's expressed that he's going to have his body frozen.
His whole body? I just thought it was his head.
They're just going to freeze his head?
That's what I... He only paid for the head. I didn't know he was getting the whole body. I don't know. Maybe he's got his whole body.
Is it a special deal? I mean...
I don't know. I just assume...
Why would somebody freeze their head?
Well, they freeze their brain. He's really interested in freezing his brain, isn't he? I mean, that's what I understand, not his body.
But it's probably going to happen two rooms down. They'll pickle me or they'll put stuff in to keep my dead brain and my dead body alive. The soul is the key here, because there's an agreement that the soul is the essence of an individual and your consciousness. And if you study the dictionary definition of soul, it's kind of embarrassing. It's very much like the dictionary definition of brain.
All of the history of all of the mysticism religions have all suggested that who we are is not our body and who we are is not our thinking mind. Timothy's going in the face of that at the moment.
Yes.
He is carrying philosophical materialism to an exquisite, exquisite penultimate point.
I wandered barefoot through the haze. My hair was long and straight. Time out of body, out of mind. And if you never see me again, remember flowers, not guns. And beaded vests and tattered jeans again. Time out of body, out of mind. Probably find diggers, probably won't go home. Probably find the pots of gold and rainbows all the same. It's a psychedelic baby of the mind. A Coney Island baby of the mind. Time out of body, out of mind.
It's true, a much higher percentage of people in California who have come because they want something different. They want to can do things they can't do back there.
I see flowers, I listen to flutes, I see searching young people looking for beauty. I see joy, I see no guns, I see no handcuffs. I think this is a holy place. It looks perhaps strange to the whiskey-drinking middle-class person, but every new religion, every new sacrament looks strange.
He said, it's my mission to introduce this drug to the world. He said it like a general. If there are a few casualties, I still have to look at the larger picture.
And when he saw those 20,000-30,000 people at the Human Being, it really affected his mind. He had a speech prepared,
right,
which he didn't make, and he looked out at that crowd and he said, turn on, tune in,
that's right,
and drop out.
Right. And you know why he didn't make that speech?
Drop out from college,
yeah.
Drop out from your jobs, drop out.
Right. And that became the mantra.
Turn on, tune in, and drop out.
Well, I mean, it's no secret that the Beatles took LSD, and they took LSD very early on, before, you know, in 66, 67, when Sgt. Pepper's was coming out.
This was a real historic event. It totally changed the scope and opened up pop culture.
Did the Beatles learn about LSD through Timothy Leary?
Who didn't at the time, you know, I think. And, I mean, the Beatles were definitely publicly supportive of his cause when it was happening. You know, John and Yoko and Tim were always in touch, and the Beatles saw the Maharishi. That's when I think Tim and John first met. And they did, of course, in 1969, the hotel Give Peace a Chance.
Albert Hofmann was the discoverer of lysergic acid. It wasn't snake oil. It wasn't phony cancer cures. It was something that changed my life for the better, and changed the lives of almost everybody that I know, who I care about.
What about going out a window and getting involved with the sidewalk 12 floors under?
Well, hundreds of thousands of people have taken LSD. How many people have done that? The statistics show that taking LSD is no more dangerous than signing up for a four-year course at Harvard College. A certain percentage of people who do either are going to get into trouble, but there's no scientific evidence that LSD causes any such...
any distortion of the sort of root, say, suicide statistic, or the root...
or mental hospital commitment. There's no evidence.
Leary terrified an entire generation of parents. I mean, he wanted... they wanted all their kids to get the same kind of education that Leary himself had had. Parents wanted their kids to be PhDs. I mean, Leary, after all, was a PhD himself. The psychedelic experience was a very grand one, and was almost too, it was on one level almost too easy to come by. Like, why work so hard if you can have a vision just by taking a pill? He did present a lot of temptations to a lot of people that were very hard to resist, but most of the people I knew who spent a year or two completely tripped out. I mean, one's a doctor, one's a lawyer, one's a judge.
He came from a pod of protection, and it was inevitable he would get busted.
Well, yeah, it was a possession of two roaches of marijuana that were found in an ashtray of a car by a cop. It was notorious at planting. You know all this stuff about the O.J. Trial planting. Wow, I learned a lot about the agricultural tendencies of cops to plant.
Until he announced he was going to be governor. And that's when they started the heavy surveillance on Tim and wanted to put him away.
While he was running for governor, suddenly his bail was revoked, and he was running against Ronald Reagan.
In fact, I've never been legitimately arrested. I'm in prison now because one evening I was in a parked car and a policeman came up to the car and opened the door against my wishes, made a pass at the ashtray and said, "You're under arrest for..." I said, "For what?" He said, "For marijuana." I said, "What marijuana?" He reached in his pocket. He pulled out two joints that I'd never seen before, half joints, and said, "You're under arrest." A year later, in Orange County, you know Orange County, jury believed the policeman's story and found me guilty of possession of marijuana. Now then the judge, instead of giving me bail, as I was entitled to for appeal, held up a book that I had been writing and said, "Your ideas are dangerous and we're not going to give you bail. We're going to put you in prison to keep you quiet."
The old charge, the same charge that was made against Socrates, of corrupting the youth. And that's why Leary was considered the most dangerous man alive, for the same reason Socrates was.
When Nixon called me the most dangerous man alive, wonderful. Wouldn't you want to have someone like Nixon call you that?
Did he say the most dangerous man alive or the most dangerous man in America?
Oh, who cares?
I don't just wonder.
The most dangerous man he could think of. Oh, he includes all Democrats in that, too. When Nixon got involved, then we had hard times, and... We couldn't do what we were doing. Damn right. It was a joke. At one point, I was involved in four or five legal criminal things happening with posses and informers and FBI teams. So definitely we could not sit around in the forest and meditate by the waterfall. Hell, we were out there like any other persecuted group.
Poor baby. Hey, it's catching me. Yeah, caught.
What are you doing in prison? What do you do on a day-by-day basis?
I have no trouble keeping myself alert. There's plenty to do here. But the main thing I'm doing is taking advantage of this... opportunity to study society from this very interesting vantage point. I'm talking to prisoners, I'm listening to them, I'm doing some writing.
My literary career zoomed when they put me in prison. I had no rent to pay, I had no job to report to, I had no family situation, didn't have to produce erections and orgasm, you know, no phones. I was free to read and write. It's been known throughout centuries.
by philosophers that reading can best be done in a prison.
It's a description of the early acid trips that define the whole way people think about LSD.
Politics of Ecstasy that
right.
you published.
These are the political writings that sparked the whole rebellious 60s. Now, Timothy is no longer just a Jean provocateur. He's really a historical figure that has had an impact. So now we're not just looking at him as an immediate threat to the establishment. Now we're looking at him as someone who really engendered many of the ideas that are becoming the establishment ideas.
The fact that he, you know, escaped from prison.
Yeah.
Now that's big stuff.
That's big stuff.
That's big stuff. That's, you know, that's mythic.
I had to walk at night across the prison yard and climb on top of a tree to get on top of a roof and go across the roof where the telephone cable was going out for the gate, and I had to shimmy across this. I'd been doing push-ups like for 3 months, and I was in but halfway across I realized I couldn't do it. But I want to say we all know it, the human body spirit has resources there. I broke Olympic records at the age of 50.
No man, I don't think, really can fathom the idea of climbing over barbed wire fence and dodging gun trucks, dodging searchlights.
Well, I went underground in this country, got a fake passport, and I shaved off all my hair, and I wore glasses. And I was a Republican businessman named McClellan. I mean, really, it's embarrassing, but the Senate Committee on Passport Fraud used my pictures as an example of how skillful the fraud could be. And then I was, boom, prison. I went to the real heavy-duty places like Folsom. That's the Harvard of the California system. Folsom is where the old-time professional criminals go. And when they put me in the cell next to Manson, they were doing it out of a game. And they just kept me there for 3 or 4 days, and then they let me out.
Was there any contact between you and Manson at that point?
He was talking to me all the time. Giving me advice, telling me what to do, where I made mistakes. I never felt any bitterness or any fear. I knew that I was prominent enough that they weren't going to kill me or gouge my eyes out. But boy, those guys really, they can throw it at you if they want to.
2 years ago, Leary surfaced into prominence again by lighting up to smoke at the Austin, Texas airport. It was a protest against the smoking ban. He was promptly arrested.
Well, I've been through several taboos. We had taboo about sex. When I grew up as a kid, you couldn't talk about sex. I mean, it was hard to understand the sexual revolution, the drug revolution. Before the 60s, doctors had drugs, and you had to have diseases for drugs, and the idea that chemicals, neurochemicals, could be used by intelligent people trained to learn how to operate their brain. That was a big taboo. Big taboo.
I think between like this generation and our generation,
you guys scared the fucking shit out of me.
Because back then there was acid and mushrooms and psychedelics, and now
there's coke and crack and everything.
It's not to be set now. I mean, it's not to be
set. Yeah, so young.
Like crack and crank and PCP. It's so much more deadly now. It's scary, you know. But I think that's what people like. I think just that living on the edge like that.
I don't care. I'm a friend of the Lizard King. I don't care. All right.
Okay. Time has come for you to seek new levels of reality. Your ego and your name game are about to cease. You're about to be set face to face with the clear light. John Lennon, told me that he took his second LSD and they read this to him. What the bullshit is that about, you know, naked, spotless intellect is like a transparent vacuum? And he was right. It was just poetic babble.
He said to a mystic, for example, that...
You're never a mystic for more than
five minutes.
5 minutes, yeah.
But a man sitting on a mountain in a state of fasting...
That's bullshit.
That's bullshit? Total bullshit.
Well,
Well, people do that. I mean, they climb.
They don't get the same consciousness.
They climb the flagpoles in America.
I don't think Tim is really on a spiritual path, actually, to tell you the truth.
I don't think he's a mystic.
He's not a mystic.
I don't think so.
He's never had a spiritual teacher. He's never been able to take anybody as a spiritual teacher.
If you're going to freeze after clinical death, it seems to me you're freezing meat.
What happens if we're contacted by extraterrestrials? What's the scenario then?
Well, if we're contacted by extraterrestrials, of course, number one, who knows? And it raises some interesting questions. Why would a self-respecting species on some star system up there that has evolved to the extent they can package bodies and send them 200 light years, why would they come to a small little swampy planet like this? It's a third stone from the sun, and we're way out of that. It kind of boggles my mind. You know, a lot of the lovely middle-aged ladies in the Midwest are talking about being abducted and sexually molested by extraterrestrials. Why would an intelligent space person come all the way down to Iowa and kidnap a 70-year-old grandmother to abuse her sexually? I mean, it boggles the mind.
In August, all this terrible stuff happened. The first thing was that we got the news that Jerry Garcia had died, you know, and then I got the news Leary is dying. And I went, oh my God, this is so terrible. I just felt really hammered. And then somewhere I saw a news item that said, Leary says he's thrilled that he's dying. First, it was just like a smack in the face. And then after about 1 second, I just went, thank God for this man. Here's a guy who's a public figure who is wise. He's seen through. He's lived a long life. He's done so many great things. He's going, I'm dying. I'm excited. What do you think is out there? You know, I'm going to get to find out.
See, I don't basically care whether I come back again or not. I've lived the most exciting life anyone I know of, and I wouldn't mind a few million years just sacking out. The concept that the human body is a car and that the human brain or the soul uses it to drive around, that's Buddhism, that's Hinduism. That's the fact that the body's a vehicle. Take your brain around to where your brain wants you to go.
I don't know anybody else in the world that can move in and out of their body like you, though. You actually were moving in and out of your body.
Well, anyone that's ever had a hallucinating experience, anyone that's taken any good dope, come on.
I hope that Timothy Leary, if he's reconstituted in the future, will be just as much of a troublemaker as he was in this century.
See, quantum physics gave us the real term to describe what happens when you take a powerful psychedelic plant or drug. Chaos. Chaos. Everyone, all the physicists say now, chaos is the basic nature of the universe is chaos. Chaos, of course, is extreme complexity that the human mind can't understand right now. And the fun of existence is to keep taking different pieces of the chaos and learning how to deal with the chaos. You can't change it, but you can surf it. I like the idea of surfing the waves of chaos.
You extricate yourself from the structures of your own mind. You really are, I guess, surfing with chaos. I guess that's one way of looking at it.
Well, there's the terrible sadness that you feel. And then... my daughter, she wanted to have her organs donated so that there was a lot of midnight paperwork because it was a Catholic hospital. And Catholic hospitals don't like anything that allows the individual to decide. The Catholic Church is against birth control, it's against abortion, it's against donating your organs. They belong to God, and so it took a lot of time to... I don't know if this answers your question, but it's a deeply moving experience. You have a problem. Couldn't you make it sound as though I answer the leg? Of course, it's going to be We're going to take a bunch of skin off of my leg here and put it over here. I won't be able to walk for, what, a couple of days?
There are probably a billion human beings would love to watch me die as slowly and as painfully as possible. All of them Republicans and
communists. Would you like to record that for posterity?
What?
Would you like to record that for the future?
Record what?
Your death. I mean,
you
always...
I've just explained to you, my death, it's going to be recorded, it's going to be, probably on World Wide Web.
Tricky question for anyone to answer. I've lived through the 30s and the 40s and the 50s and the 60s, and I think anyone who's still erect after those years has had his sanity tested. Am I insane? I think I'm the strongest, sanest person around.
Very pleased to meet you. What we're doing
now... Thank you. This is a new experience.
I'm sure you'll enjoy it. Flying a bald cap first, just so we don't get this material in your hair. It's alginate, which is a material that dentists use when they make impressions of your mouth. It doesn't stick to skin or hair.
Unbelievable, it's on TV.
There are two steps. We're going to apply the alginate first. Once that sets up, which just takes a few moments, we're going to apply plaster bandage, which is what broken bones are cast with, which is a rigid material. The alginate is soft.
Oh, that's my... Oh, there, my favorite. Oh, look. That's the greatest scene in movie history. I love that. My boyfriend, Mercado, said you're supposed to take care of me, and you're going to do what I tell you to do. See that? I want to dance.
I want to win that dance with you, and I want that cup. Got it? What a scene.
So you'll only be under for about 15 or 20 minutes at the very most.
Experience, I'll tell you.
Mm-hmm.
You want us I've to come back some tomorrow. Of the most expensive whorehouses in Bombay and Calcutta, but nothing like this.
Compares to this.
Did you plaster caulking?
Well, no, we're not caulk specialists, but...
you know the plastic caulk...
Caulking? Like...
No, in 1960, like, there was a bunch of...
The plaster casters. Yeah. I know of them, yes.
Hendrix was...
Well, yeah, well, you had all these rock stars, I won't name their names, the white ones, and then it was going like this. Hendrix was like this. It's a joke.
You look like the mummy. This is so fantastic.
Wow.
Oh, it's such a mummy. It's a pretty
standard.
It's a real mummy.
93
wives. Hendrix the third.
Mm-hmm.
That's 3,000.
Probably
about 4 minutes.
Can I set up on you?
Set up will be about 2 more minutes, and it will start to take it off. Thank you very much, Dr.
Pull yourself out, pull back against it. Here it comes, slowly, easily.
Rebirth. There we go.
Reanimation.
Very nice.
How are you?
Perfect. Now we can clean you up and go off.
That's a good place to stop, huh?
That's a good place to stop.
Cut.